A person will worship something, have no doubt about that. We may think our tribute is paid in secret in the dark recesses of our hearts, but it will out. That which dominates our imaginations and our thoughts will determine our lives and character. Therefore, it behooves us to be careful what we worship, for what we are worshiping, we are becoming. I think everyone knows our speaker, but just in case, Mary Ryan has worked in the field of psychotherapy for 30 years. Currently, she has a private practice with offices in Springfield, Jacksonville, and in her car on the road in between. She trains therapists in Chicago and St. Louis, facilitates a group of inmates in prison, and teaches at Benedictine University as an adjunct faculty in psychology. She has three children, Joe, Shay, and Gwen, and has been part of this congregation for 14 years. Please welcome Mary Ryan.
I think I had, this will be four presentations in 5 days, and I just finished the hardest one. Whew. Okay, yesterday I was presenting in Hyde Park to a Unitarian young adult conference, and I was using film clips. The conference was called The Hero's Journey, and I was using film clips from The Wizard of Oz, and turns out there's new information in about Glinda. Yep, jury's still out, but we think that maybe Glinda has masterminded the whole thing. I mean, what are the odds? Dorothy's house falls on her archenemy, and then she convinces Dorothy that she has to go on a long journey down the yellow brick road, and she gives her high heels. So, it turns out that the high heels are coveted by her other archenemy, Wicked Witch of the West. So, I think she sort of orchestrated the dust-up between Dorothy and the Wicked Witch, and you know, it turns out she's got Dorothy doing all her dirty work. So there's probably going to be a sequel soon. I just found this out. Thought I would share that. Yes. Dorothy had to go on the long journey, and this archetypal image of the hero, the divine savior, the archetype image of the forest, flying monkeys. I don't think Jung used any of those, but I have been a student of Carl Jung for many, many years. I think I read a couple of paragraphs so I could pass a test in graduate school, and that was about it for 5-10 more years. But in my late 20s, I was reading Joseph Campbell. And you can't read Joseph Campbell without being led back to Jung. So I was very, very intrigued by this business of long journeys, his idea about life being the hero's journey, and finding the hero within is a really important concept from Jung. He was a devout student of Sigmund Freud. He was in his 20s, probably late 20s, when he wrote to Freud and sent him a paper that he'd written. Freud was a neurologist, and Jung was a psychiatrist, and he was very interested in what Freud's theories were. And so he sent them this paper, and Freud invited him to come and visit him. And they met, and they started talking, and they talked for 13 hours. They were pretty devoted, actually, to each other. And Jung was considered the heir apparent. He really had this sort of the keys to the kingdom of the great and famous Sigmund Freud. Freud gave us the unconscious, really. He was sort of the, in my view, the Columbus of the unconscious. Nobody thought we had one until Freud made that apparent. So Jung is the sort of the right hand to Sigmund Freud, and they agreed on many, many things. Freud's idea of religion was probably best summed up in a work he did called The Future of Illusion. And he said very little harshly, he said, religion is a search for the lost protective parent. He was not a fan. He considered himself an atheist. And when his golden boy, Jung, who had read Goethe's Faust and Swedenborg and Nietzsche, all his life he had been a student of those. He loved really mysticism. And so it disappointed Freud. They argued a lot. And as Carl Jung began to individuate from his great idol, he and Freud had many disagreements. So on Jung's path through life, he hit about midlife, and he began to argue with his real father figure. And it's Jung often calls midlife the second adolescence. And for him, at about 43, that's really what happened. He broke away from a parent figure. And at that time, the idea became more and more apparent to Jung that there is an important phase of life called individuation, to divide away. His term individuation is one of his greatest contributions, actually, to psychology. And its meaning for me is individuation is becoming who you were truly meant to be. And he found that, in fact, there were many, many detours on the journey, wrong turnings, flying monkeys, difficult encounters that really are required. They're actually part of it. They're required and part of it. But his crisis came about 43, and he took himself away. He divided away. He separated. He lost his position as the president of the Psychoanalytic Society. He and Freud stopped speaking, and they never started speaking again. Never again. So there was such a divergence on his path that he went into a 2 or 3 year depression. And from that time, he wrote a great deal. He painted, he reflected, and he did a lot of inner work. And when I say a lot, I mean a lot. He did 8.5 pounds worth of inner work. This is his diary. actually, it's two diaries. So the first half, Renata, you want to read? It's in German. So 4 pounds is in German, and it's in his handwriting. It's in beautiful calligraphy. And as you can see, he did a lot of paintings. You probably can't see.
The famous red book.
That's the famous red book. He called it the red book. So he did a lot of writing and drawing. It was not released. It was, you know, for him, it was a private diary, so it was locked up. And really, you should have seen us. We had a red book discussion group in St. Louis where I've been studying with the Jung Society, and we all walked through the parking lot with our 8.5-pound red books. And the second time we met, Rose decided that she would scan some pages we could talk about. So our chiropractors like that better. So this is the red book, the famous red book. It was not published until a few years ago. And so it really was locked up for almost 100 years. And 50 years after his death, we have the red book. The last 4 pounds is writing. It's all in English. So he wrote about, you know, expect for him to badmouth Freud in here, but he didn't do that. He wrote about his own battle. And it wasn't the battle with Freud. It wasn't about the battle with the world. It was the battle inside, a battle within. And he writes here, I was driven to ask myself in all seriousness, what is the myth you are living? He found that so much of spirituality, for him, it didn't matter whether spirit was out there or in there. It did not matter the location. What mattered was who wins the fight. And for him, this book is about the fight. From this book, from his 2 years, we really have probably the majority of what has become the best of Jung. It was from those years, from his trying to work out this inner battle. And from that, he is also very famous for the ego-self axis. And he talked about the ego being that which drives us by fear. It is what the world wants of us. It is about our response to that fear. So some of us will become very controlling because of that fear. Some of us will become very avoidant, evade the path altogether. And some of us will become very compliant in order not to go on the journey. He talked about getting on the journey means that we have to go into the dark. But if we want to avoid it, we can stay in the castle, turn up the TV, get a six-pack. And he talks about that as walking in shoes too small. Walking in shoes too small. There are a couple of things that will drive us to stay off the path, off the journey, and skip it altogether. Those are ways in which we fear, things that intimidate us and things that dominate us. He said that evil is really the domination of our life by fear. That's what his definition of evil was. He saw very little of spirituality being external, but he saw that too often we are focused on the external, what the world wants of us. And he said, conversely, what we need to pay attention to is where are your energies? We need to pay attention to what the soul wants of us. He called it the capital S self. So there's the ego, and the internal battle is with the self. The ego's not really the villain here. The ego simply wants our comfort and our security and our safety, and it will do whatever it can to get that. So belongingness generally makes us pretty safe. And so if we just do what the world wants of us, we could stay safe. It's not something to declare a winner about. We don't need to do without the ego altogether. We don't need to amputate that. I cringe when I see self-help books that, you know, talk about leaving the ego behind. And one very famous bestseller author talks about having left his ego on a park bench and hasn't seen it in 8 years. I'm just jealous, I think, but Jung is talking about that the ego needs to be a part of the self, not separate and not running us. So he finds that questions like, where are our energies? He called neurosis. He said, neuroses are our private religions. So it's what we worship. That reading from today about be careful what you worship. Pay attention to what you worship. Because where we put our energies, what we have put on our altar, is going to define us. And generally, it could be a whole lot of neurotic suffering that we go through. So the other side of that is the soul. Now, he called it the capital S, self. And he spoke about the ego and the self for most of his career. In his 70s, he fessed up and said, oh, hell, I've been talking about the soul the whole time. But he said, you know, don't say that if you're a medical professional. They'll drive you right out of the building. He referred to it as the self, the psyche, which is a Greek word for soul. So he didn't disguise it really well, but he was talking about the soul. So a very spiritual guy, actually, very spiritual guy, but he did not use that word. In the 1920s and 40s, we didn't use the word spirituality, but he used the word religion. You can often in his writings see the difference that that he's really talking more about the concept of spirituality rather than institutionalized religion. In the 12-step program, they say religion is for people who are afraid of going to hell, and spirituality is for those who've already been there. And I absolutely think he would agree. Absolutely. Let's see. I should do the right thing. And, 3 days ago I realized that I don't even know when he was born. I'm like a fan of Jung. One of my kids gave me for Christmas a caricature of Jung on a t-shirt, and it says, "Forever Jung." I had dinner with friends a couple weeks ago, and she came to the door. She opened the door and she said, "I got a joke for you." I said, "What's that?" She said, "A psychologist walks into a bar, asks for a drink, and the bartender says, 'I'm sorry, I can't serve you.'" And psychologist says, "Well, why not?" The bartender says, "Well, you're far too young." That would be me. So, ego self axis. That is what I believe he has become famous for. There is not, I promise you, not a week that goes by that I don't reference almost most of his important works. I have been driving to St. Louis for 15 years. It's just going to take that one discussion group, and I couldn't quit. So a little hooked, but I was asked to be one of the speakers at their Midwest conference, and I said, "You realize I'm from Central Illinois, where you have to hide the fact that you are a Jungian-oriented therapist, because most people think he's a whack job. And they said, well, yeah, we know that. I said, you understand that I haven't published anything. Yep, we got that. And you also know that I'm not a Jungian analyst. Jungian analysts spend at least five years, covering the 17, 18 volumes, collected works, and they know when he was born. I had to look it up. He was born in 1875, and he lived for 85 years, and he died in 1961. Okay, I covered that. I think far more exciting is what he gave us in terms of the concepts of individuation, our need to grow and be whole. Robert Johnson is a Jungian analyst, and he writes, we are born whole, and hopefully we will die whole. But all the stuff that happens in between, we get detoured off the path into the dark woods, detoured on our journey. We take wrong turns. And Jung wrote about that. He said that God is all things that cross my path violently and recklessly, all things which upset my subjective views, plans, and intentions. Though that which changes the course of my life for better or worse. That's his belief about God. And the psyche and the soul has a whole different plan for us than what the ego does. The ego wants us to be comfortable and belong. One of my favorite Jungian analysts grew up here in Springfield, Illinois, went to Zurich and studied. His name is James Hollis, and he grew up on Hoover Street in the Cabbage Patch. He said, we are not meant to be safe, sane, or similar. We are meant to individuate. We are meant to be whole. And sometimes that's going to be in difficult ways. A few weeks ago, I was preparing for my class at Benedictine, and I really wondered how I was going to get them to concentrate on the theories of personality psychology when they had just found out that Benedictine was closing their undergraduate program, and they were getting detoured. And I thought, detoured? We got to talk about Jung. That's what we're going to do, is talk about Jung. So I printed up some handouts. Had a few left over. So I decided I would share with you, as I shared with them, my absolute favorite quote of Carl Jung's. And it is, I think, one of his greatest gifts to any of us who found themselves detoured off the path that we intended, that we'd planned for. And he said that the right way to wholeness is made up, the right way to wholeness. I have said it for years and forgot the word right. It really significant. He said the right way to wholeness is made up of fateful detours and wrong turnings. Thank you so much. So in the importance of that journey, absolutely essential to it is to risk. The hero always has to leave the castle, leave what's familiar, and go out sometimes alone, most of the time alone, without a map. This is written by Anonymous. To laugh is to risk appearing the fool. To weep is to risk appearing sentimental. To reach out for another is to risk exposing our true self. To place our ideas, our dreams, before the crowd is to risk loss. To love is to risk not being loved in return. To hope is to risk despair. To try is to risk failure. And to live is to risk dying.